Okay, boys and girls, we got the workbench cleaned off. This is probably the cleanest that you will ever see it. Of course, from what I've seen of Terry Sumner's workplace page on Facebook, y'all ought to check that out. I'm not the only one that suffers the malady of having an enormously long workbench, and I'm working in a space this big. What we're going to talk about right now, what you're going to need, or what I suggest you need to continue on. These are just basic things. These are things that I work with every single day. You acquire them over time, that's quite all right. But you will need some basic tools, some basic product to get going on this. I'm quite sure that many of you have read in the magazine articles that I've written that it's very, very important to spend more money on initially coming out of the gate on your tools and on your product rather than kits. You can acquire kits any day. I would much rather see you spend $400 on your tools and product and buy 5 kits rather than the other way around, because without this you're not going to be able to produce a quality model. As I said, indicated just a couple minutes ago with Kathy's car, that's what you can do coming out of the gate. So the very first thing, yes, I'm being mercenary, I don't care, I can't emphasize this enough, these at $60 to your door, okay? 65 with the mail. Airbrushing DVD, 90 minutes, A to Z, how I do it. Follow these steps religiously, you're gonna be producing glass-like paint jobs in no time at all. If you have a hard time believing that, saying, oh my God, no, well guess what? There are far too many testimonials, both on my website, both on the forums. If you go back and look and Google my name and do a search, you'll find out that I don't have to say a word about it. I can chirp from now until doomsday about it, but I let other people do the talking for me. They loved it, and it's a very, very useful tool. Again, it's a tool. It's a learning. It should be in your library. It should be in your toolbox, for lack of a better term. Then you got the tips and tricks. 2-disc set, 4 hours of exactly how I do everything. As I indicated earlier, the tough part about this, I can only touch on it. There's just not enough time. Are we going to go into depth on this YouTube channel? Oh, hell yes, but you need the basics, and here it is right here. Enough of that. All right, first things first. What we're going to do, what we decided to do, we decided to come out of the gate with this kit. I don't know too many people that don't like a fat fendered drag car. This was one of the nicest kits around. There's a few little pitfalls here and there, little design things. We're going to cover all of that. You will go from step one to from this table, and including opening this up, go all the way through every single step of the way until your finished model is sitting on the table. That's number one. Okay, next up, number 11 knives. Can't go wrong. You need it. I'm not a great proponent of nippers. A lot of guys will use these to take parts off of, or God forbid, they will shoot the parts while they're still on the trees. Okay, that's all well and good. I mean, oh, it holds the parts. I'm going to teach you a different way in further segments. My way works a lot better, because every time that you take your knife, after the parts have been painted, you cut them off, you leave a mark. There's a white mark where the paint doesn't cover. You touch it in with the brush, it sticks out to like the proverbial sore thumb. To go along with a decent supply of number 11 blades, don't be chintzy, okay? You're cutting up on what, $25 plus cost per kit these days. Don't be afraid to use the blades. You want a good, sharp, clean cut every time. You might go through 3, 4, 5 blades per kit. So what? Blades are like just that cents on the dollar as compared to what the cost of a kit is. You don't want to leave divots. You don't want to leave rough edges. None of that. Where are they at? Here we are. You are going to need scalpel blades. Squadron sells them. They're not all that expensive. What I do is I cut the back of the blade off. It slides right into the number 11 knife. This makes bare metal foiling so much easier because it is so damn sharp that it's just a whisper cut. All you have to do is trace it, come off. As I said, in further segments, you'll actually watch me use these. They will save you time and aggravation above and beyond belief. Now, another thing for the bare metal foil. Now, when I did the original, and this is what I'm talking about expounding upon what is on the Tips and Tricks DVD or what is on the Airbrush DVD. Those were put out almost 10 years ago, okay? So I'm never one to let grass grow under my feet. I'm always learning, I'm always pushing, I'm always looking for something, a better way of doing things. When I came out with the original Tips and Tricks, applying bare metal foil, I used Q-tips. Okay, they work, I proved it. The one thing that I cannot teach, and it's going to be patience. You're going to have to learn to develop it. I see a lot of you guys, you start off with projects, and you're doing quite well, but then all of a sudden it's like, oh, gotta go. Why? Don't rush this. These leave fuzzies. So, a couple years back, I'm walking through Esther's Hobby Shop in Millville. I look again, I'm like, what the hell is this? Well, Tamiya came out with Cotton Hobby applicators. Now, these have a point on them, okay? They're hard. There's no fuzziness. You don't leave fuzzies. That was always the drawback on using ordinary Q-tips because it's got a fuzziness to its material. And when you're doing bare metal foil, it would leave the little fuzzies. Sometimes it would get caught. You'd have to be in there with tweezers pulling or trying to pull it off with your fingers. These don't. They get up in. There's four different sizes. Buy the four different sizes. For $4.50, you get 50 of them. And they have a multitude of uses. You can use them to clean your airbrush with. You can use them, naturally, to put the bare metal foil on. Sometimes when you're using a wash or chalk, get in tight into the tight crevices on, say, a motor, or getting down in at an angle on your chrome. These will get it down, and it'll get it smooth. You won't have the tearing or whatnot that usually goes with trying to use an applicator. Now, granted, there's going to be the boys that, you know, they still got their baptismal money wrapped up in the original diaper going, well, hell, why should I spend half? I could just go to Walmart and buy myself one of them little makeup brushes and, you know, foam and it'll work. Mm-mm, no. You do what you want to do. But that, I'm going to show you. I'm going to prove to you. Everything that I show you, everything I do, I did it. I slept with Lady Trilliner, okay? She's wicked. She's expensive. And what I'm trying to do, I'm trying to help you avoid the pitfalls that I've already suffered, for lack of a better word. Bare metal foil, airbrushing, I'm going to show you the simplest way of doing it all, okay? Start off with the DVDs. We're going to work up over the top of that. All right, now, another thing we're going to need, and I'm probably going to have to sit down here so y'all can see what I'm doing here. You're going to need wet dry sandpaper. You know, your local auto parts sells this. 220, 320, 400, 600, 800, and 1500. There's different sizes in between. This is what I use. We're going to use this to prep the body with, okay? Another thing that's not sitting on the table right now that we do need would be a metal bowl. Jake, I don't know what the hell I did with it. Jake comes through. Okay, the reason that I'm suggesting a metal bowl is because ceramic or Pyrex, whatever, they have a memory to them. If they get scratched, then you get little bits of junk, debris, or whatever. When you're wet sanding, sometimes that'll go in, especially when you're doing a polish shot. Buy your own. Go to Kmart, whatever. They're cheap. Don't be stealing the wives' stuff. It doesn't work out too good for you. Okay. Now, for continued polish out, Micromark, sells this micro mesh polishing kit. Now you can either buy the kit where you get the squares starting at 2,400, goes all the way up to 12,000. Or what I started doing, I started buying the 4x6 sheets. You can cut them into fours, you get more for your money. Along the lines of keeping up with the polishing and whatnot, I have here naturally the Novice 2, the number one. I also use Scratch-X from Meguiar's. I use the Mirror Glaze from Meguiar's, which is a swirl remover. And I use the Professional High-Tech Yellow Wax. Actually, if you've got slight orange peel, this and the swirl remover can remove it. You just have to be careful of how hard you press and push. Another thing, and this would thrill the cockles of any housewife's heart, get yourself a set or two of these. What I do is, like with the sandpaper, okay, this is 1500. I cut everything up into little squares. This way it's ready to go. And I write down what number's on it. I lay them out and I just work. When I'm done with a certain grit, 320, tuck it away. Then I go to the 400, so on and so forth. There's two projects coming down the road. Actually, the Willys, which is going to be show table to, work table to show table. The second one's going to be a weathering project. Now, me personally, I'm going to be using the 57 Ford Gasser wagon. You can use whatever you want. You can either buy what I'm using and, you know, go with me along the steps, or pick another kit. Doesn't matter. I mean, we're just going to beat the living hell out of it. We're going to need... Now, I just found these at the hobby shop the other day. It's called the Weather System. Okay. That or a Alpha Color Earth Tone chalk set for weathering. It's got rust. Actually, give you an idea, there's the different colors. I'm going to show you how to use them. I have another set over there. It's probably got 32 different colors in it, various shades of the spectrum. I'm going to show you how to use them and why. How Mother Nature beats the hell out of a finish, and it helps blend it and make it more realistic in appearance. Let's go with next up is your glue. Now, what I have here is, this right here is Instacure. It's a medium viscosity. I build all my cars with this. Why I like this: if you glue two parts together with this, something happens. You drop the model, the glue joint itself breaks. It breaks clean. In other words, the parts don't break with it. We'll cover on the show, on a show segment, I'll show you exactly what happens. One thing I definitely want to do throughout this whole thing, and I'm a firm believer in this, this is a visual age, for lack of a better term. Seeing's believing. So anything that I tell you, I'm going to show you eventually. Might not be today, might not be tomorrow, might be next month. We're going to go through this every single step of the way. Whether you build weathered, whether you build shine, whether you build street rods, street machines, stock car, whatever you build, anything that's on this channel from now on, you're going to be able to apply all the way across the spectrum, no matter what genre you build in. Plastistruck Plastic Weld and Plastistruck Bondine. I use these primarily for installing glass. Again, I will show you why. What I love about this, you take a micro mesh brush, This is the super fine. I'll show you how to use them and why I use them as glue applicators. I'm not one for because sure as hell you're going to get it where you don't need it to be. You take this, dip it in. Guys struggle with putting glass in. Hold glass, touch it. It's got a capillary action to it. So if I touch it here, you can actually, and we will have it on camera, you can actually watch it move. Touch that in a couple different places, your glass is in. Now, if you have to remove the glass, you simply tap it and it pops back out, and it pops out clean, and it doesn't break the glass, nor does it affect the body in any way. Bob Dudak steered me toward crystal effects. This is great for using for gauge faces. It's great for installing headlights. Actually, you can use this to install body panels, like a lower valance, upper valance. It dries clear, and it's got a decent bond. You can use this to install glass also. Another thing that I use is this GNS Hypo Cement. I use this also for installing headlight bezels, taillight bezels. You don't want to use the glue because it will dull out the back of it or it will melt it. This stuff is unreal. It dries clear and it's very strong. It doesn't, how would I say this? It lends itself to a variety of uses. Okay, next up, got the glues out of the way. Sharpie markers. A wide range of uses. You can use the silver, you can touch in on a bumper on it. You can do you can touch in on your headlight bezels. You can use this for doing the chrome rings around on your interiors for your gauges. You can do the doorknobs. I suggest using a bare metal foil. Once again, this is all going to be covered on down the line. Various colors too. You can use this red. This is the fine tip. You can use this for your speedometer needles, for your gauge needles, for your drag cars, gauge clusters. Pin vices. Always nice to have one or two. They make the blades. All of this stuff is readily available at a well-stocked hobby shop. Razor saw blades. Going to need it because it's a couple segments we're going to be doing. We're going to be pro street and back half in cars. Cutting frames apart to extend. When we kit bash, if we want to say, you know, one of the projects that's, you know, going to be coming along is going to be the Ravel 40 Ford. We're going to put a gasser frame under one. We're also going to put the Willys Pro Street. As I said, take parts from A kit to build B kit, take the motor out of C kit, so on and so forth. You take those three kits, you put them together, and you got one hell of a model. Can't emphasize this more strongly. Surgical scissors. Couple different pairs. One pair needs to be set aside to do decals and decals alone. And I'll explain later. I will actually show you why, what happens. You can buy a set of these. These are Scribers. Marcos Cruz did a tutorial on this in Model Car Magazine Forum and under the questions category. It would behoove you to go take a look at it. We're going to cover it also. Marcos had to describe it and use photographs. We're going to do it right here, right now. Everything that we do, you're going to be right over my right shoulder so you can see exactly what we're going to do. These are cut up pieces of the micro mesh kit. Gives you some idea of what you're going to be working with. Now for the weathering, and for rust creating, drill tearing bodies up and everything, this kit, I think it's like for $9 or $10 from Mark and Mark's catalog. They're worth their weight in gold. Like I said, not that expensive. They fit perfectly in a Dremel tool. Okay, speaking of the devil, always nice to have one of these. Teach you how to radius out rear wheel wells with it. Teach you how to beat the living hell out of a body with it. Always nice to have it so that you can use it as a cutoff wheel. Now, you need a couple rolls of this, okay? We'll talk about this later, how to care for it. Yeah, it needs care, because otherwise Murphy will get in your mess and you won't know which direction to turn to get away from it. All right, now, another thing. Once again, you know, this was not available until a couple years ago. I used it on the recommendation of a couple of my friends that do a lot of two-tone, three-tone, four-tone. They do a lot of custom paint work on the lowrider segments. It's Tamiya tape. Comes in, I believe, three different or four different widths. I'd buy them all. 750 a shot. Oh my God, that's a lot of money. Okay, put it to you this way. You buy a kit, $25. You buy the paint. Now, if you're airbrushing, okay, you're talking $4 a bottle. If you're spray canning, well, you're talking $6, $7, maybe more, depending on whose brand you're using. You tape it off with some cheap tape, you know, whatever you're using, and you shoot it all up, and then you peel the paint. Well, you had bleed. Was it worth it? You're talking $30. We're going to be using this. You're going to see what it does. You're going to, and I'm going to show you samples and examples, and you're going to actually see me use it also. It's worth its weight in gold. Look, kids, going cheap comes back and bites you in the ass every single time. Like I said, I would much rather you put your money into this first instead of buying 40 kits. The kits are going to be out there. Believe me, the kits are going to be out there. There's kits out there now that were re-released that I wanted when I was a kid, but I couldn't afford them because I could only afford certain amount. You know, you can only buy, say, four models in one summer. Well, that's what I did. I bought what I could do. Now, what the hell, Dirk? What, 40-some-odd years later, maybe longer? I've been in this gig for, what, 55 years come March. I started when I was five. These kits are going to be there. You need this to start out with. Plain and simple. Now, let's see. I don't even know where the hell I put them. Oh, yes. For those that are in advancing age, don't laugh, you youngsters. Don't laugh. Time's coming. I said the same thing. You're going to need these. And then, when you're blind in one eye and can't see out of the other, Optivisor. Hey, what can I say? It's the greatest thing about getting older. Not old, older. All right. Next thing on the list. Oh, I'm sorry. I was remiss. For those that are my age, a little bit younger, or even older, do we remember these? Very, very nice to have. Not for the reasons that they were used for back in the day, but I will show you why. Hemostats. Four, five, six of them. Nice to have laying around the shop. Once again, all of this will be shown. We will use all of this. All I'm trying to do is set the table for you. You're going to hear me use that that phrase a lot. All I want to do is make sure that you have everything and you're ready to roll. When this goes out, we'll have roughly what, Jake, about a month? Roughly about a month. He's just nodding his head this morning. He's not talking much. I fed him breakfast, gave him coffee. He's still like a sphinx this morning. Go figure. Everything that you see here, this is what you're going to need to start off to keep up. I understand. Believe me, I know what it's like to work on a model off a TV tray. I know what it's like to have just a little bit of everything. Be patient, time will come. That's what I'm saying. If you buy one kit and you got this, or you got half of this, you're a hell of a lot further on down the road than having 10 kits and having a utility knife, a pair of clippers, and a couple paintbrushes, which leads me to the next thing. We're going to go into what you're going to need for painting. Now, the markers, as I indicated, are definitely a necessity too, because it helps with touch up and doing getting into small areas. I will caution you on this too. While they're nice to have, and they do have their uses, believe me, don't skimp on your paintbrushes. You want to go with the more expensive brushes. If you treat them well, they will last you for quite some time. I've got brushes on my carousel that I've had for 7 or 8 years. I paid $14, $15 a piece. Somebody just fell off their chair, Jake, and hit the floor.
Ah, is he nuts?
Yeah, I am. Yeah, I'm stone cold nuts. No doubt about it. But as I said, quality tools lead to quality work. If you're using a brush that's just, when you go to touch in a tiny little area or you're detail painting on something, you ruin it. Was it worth it? Nope. Once again, you're all grown kids. You do what you want to do. All I can do is suggest and guide, lead you in the right direction. You choose to follow. Okay. Now, I understand that there's some of you that are going to be using spray cans. It's fine. If you have the Witherol to be able to purchase an airbrush, I would strongly suggest it, because if you can use an aerosol can, spray can, using one of these, world of difference. World of difference. So much nicer to paint with. So much nicer result-wise. I got a buddy of mine that's a badass. His name is John Snyder. He lives in New York. Big man. Strong man. Scared to death of this thing. I had to shame him into using it. But I can't say much about that, because I'll be the first to poke fun at myself, laugh at myself, Jed. It doesn't matter. I don't care. It's all about having fun. When I come home from work late, I ended up having to work overtime. It was Christmas time, getting towards Christmas that year. I had projects that I needed to get done, because back then I was into the model railroading. I was not dealing with the model cars hardly at all. I was using aerosol. I started off with spray cans. I got to be pretty proficient with spray can. But I had everything that I needed airbrush wise. I didn't make it to the hobby shop to get the paints. I was screwed. But there it sat. I had the paints. I had the air compressor. I had the airbrush. I had everything I needed. So two choices: disappoint the customers or sit down and throw myself into the learning curve, which I did. I'm glad I did. It's not that hard. Lady trial and error for me. I know what I'm doing. I'll help guide you. First off, let me premise it with this. There is nothing wrong with a dual action airbrush. I learned off of Badger 150, which is an excellent dual action airbrush. This is a Pache H. This is a single action airbrush. You want to, if you, my recommendation would be Pache H set, readily available from DixieArt.com. Also, Hobby Lobby, some of the others, 40% coupon. Save yourself some money, get it that way. The reason that I suggest DixieArt.com, first off, you have that entire airbrush set delivered to your door for $63. Second is, they have the parts readily available. You'll have your parts within a day or two. If you need a new, say the airbrush tumbles, you smack up the needle, you smack up the spray head, you can have it within 2 days. Therein lies the drawback of the using the $20 airbrush, the $15 airbrush. Well, that's what you want to learn on. You got to start. No. You want to buy what you're going to use day in, day out. I'm not suggesting you have to spend $240, $279 and up on an airbrush. I wouldn't suggest it. This with the number 5 head gives you a perfect spray pattern. You're going to see me do it. You're going to be over my shoulder. The airbrush DVD, you're right there, you're watching me. Ding, ding, ding. It comes with a number 1, a number 3, and a number 5 head, which is fine, medium, and what they refer to as large. I use the number 5 head needle assembly. Produces stellar results. Is it the most expensive airbrush? Hell no. Is it the worst? No, it's a Chevy Caprice. It's a workhorse. I think I own, what, Jake, 6 or 7 of them?
Probably.
I use different size heads. I keep them that way. I've got one set aside for clear. I got one set aside for, metallics and pearls. And I've got one that's strictly for the standard colors. Now, up next, pipe nipples. 6 inch in length, 3/4, half, down to 1/4 or 1/8. They have a multitude of uses. What I do, I will take a model car body, I will reverse the tape, wrap it, stick the model car body on it. I could turn that body any way I want. Some guys use Tamiya stands. Some guys use coat hangers. That takes up a lot of room. I have a flash out cabinet. I paint the body and I'm careful how I go in and out. Have I knocked them over? It happens on occasion, very rarely. And it's my fault because I'm not being careful enough. But I can put maybe 15 bodies, painted bodies, and all the spoilers, balances, whatever that go with it, I can put it all in there. Also, what I like is this. I can turn it 360 degrees. You look at my cars, you're never going to see fade out at the bottom where I didn't get enough paint or whether I have to turn the stand. Mm-mm. You're done. Varying sizes. I'd suggest maybe 6 or 8 of them to start off with. Me, I got enough to probably outfit a hardware store. Okay, this right here, bare metal foil, need that too. That's how we're going to do your chrome work. Now what we're going to do is we're going to go from here, we're going to jump into the airbrush booth. What's up, kid? Light. Oh, okay. Yeah, Jake, good point. All right. This goes straight across the board, okay? What you need to do, you need to work and you need to paint under the lighting conditions that are going to be present at your shows. All the way, just about all the way across the board, it's either fluorescent or it's LED. These days. Now what I did, I went out, I removed the fluorescent fixture that was over top of the bench, and I bought 3 of the new LED lights. And I'm going to tell you what, it makes a world of difference. If you paint under a 60 watt bulb, or you weather under a 60 watt bulb, you take that and you put it underneath fluorescent lighting, you're going to be sorry. How do I know? I did, my fluorescent fixture went out one evening on me at one of my old workshops. I had 3 buildings that I needed to get done for the Ohio Valley Lines layout, which by the way is in Old Economy Village in right outside of Pittsburgh off of 65. You get a chance, go see it. It's gorgeous. However, I do these buildings, I take them out, I go set them on the layout. Way too dark. I knew better. So I ended up having to take the buildings apart and redo them. Avoid it. Good lighting. Alright, what we're going to do now, we're going to jump out into the airbrush booth. I'll show you around a little bit in there, what you need for that. And we're about ready to call this a wrap. So see you in a minute. Okay, I get a lot of questions, both on forums, Facebook pages, emails. Oh man, what kind of compressor should I buy? Well, we covered the airbrush, the H-set, Pache. I have nothing against the dual action. I love them. I think that they have a little steeper of a learning curve. My suggestion, start with the Pache H, and there's your workhorse. If you want to do fine detailing, do shading, whatever, especially for weathering, eventually you can take a step up. They serve their purpose there. Virgil Suarez uses, and he is an Iwata fan. I have yet to purchase one. It's on my wish list / round two at list. I'll get there. Now, going back to the air compressor. You can buy the hobby air compressor. I started with one. The drawback on that, they run continuously. They have a moisture trap on them. However, being that they're that size, they build up heat quick. And they develop condensation quick. You can fill that moisture trap up very quickly. By doing so, if you are not attentive to it, and if you're slinging paint and not paying attention, that water is going to go into your finish, and it's going to be guaranteed the last coat that you put on. That's just Murphy at his finest. My suggestion, if you are going to go that route, buy yourself a large moisture trap in line, down from your compressor. This way that catches it and it doesn't get into your finish through your airbrush. I would suggest, I always suggest, one step up from there. The nailers, what they refer to as the nailers, which is the circular air compressors. They have a tank on them. They have a regulator, which is a necessity also. They have storage. They come on, they come off. Drawback to it, a little bit noisy, but if you don't have to worry about that, that would be my suggestion. Actually, that would be my first choice for you. Now, me, my situation's a little different. I do a lot of airbrushing. I paint bodies for other people. They can't paint for a variety of reasons. I paint and offer bodies for sale. So my airbrushing is a lot more frequent than what yours would probably be. Over here, I have a 26-gallon Husky compressor. It serves its purpose. I love it. Noisy, yeah. Actually, in future segments, I'll be airbrushing. You'll see it come on. You watch me jump. It happens all the time. And I laugh at myself about it because I'm like, you dumbass. You knew that that was going to happen, but it still scares the living hell out of me at times. Now, you have the air compressor, and then behind me, you have three inline filters. Three? Overkill? No. Future segment, I will show you exactly why I have three. I also have an inline regulator, and this gauge, particular gauge, it's an expensive one. If you're going to use the cheaper ones, I would make sure that you use two. Here's why. Because these gauges have a tendency, if you get a little bit of moisture, if you get a little bit of oil, if you get a little bit of dirt in the line, it gets up in there, it knocks the gauge off. This particular one, a buddy of mine went to a hardware store that was / plumbing supply that was going out of business. That's a $200 gauge. It's worth its weight in gold. To me, it was worth it. I got it for a good price, but as I always say, you know, you get what you pay for, and cheap's going to bite you in the ass every time. Now, I built a header here, and the reason that I did that is because I don't, with quick connects, should have quick connects too. I believe, I'm a firm believer in blowing off moisture. A lot of guys will sit there and they will wash their model off and let it air dry. Well, you know, there's debris floating everywhere for a variety of reasons. What you have on your clothes, cleanliness is next to godliness. You want to keep your area pristine. It's the single most important thing on the planet. If you do not have a clean airbrush area, you're going to get dirt and debris in your paint. Do I? Yeah, still, on occasion. It almost cannot be avoided unless you're painting in a laboratory where you have a completely controlled atmosphere / environment. I take that airline over there, attached to an old airbrush, and I blow everything off. My paint's mixed. I immediately set the body on the pipe nipple and immediately begin to paint. This way, I don't have to worry about the debris or anything else like that. It's not sitting there where it's actually a victim or a target of Murphy. Dog hair. Somebody walks by, fuzz comes off their sweater. The list is long and varied of what can occur. Once again, it's in the airbrush DVD. It's there for a reason. All these steps. The single most important thing to model building for painting is to control your environment as best as you possibly can. Do not paint on carpet, because every time you take a step, little dust, little particles, they get up in the air and you're moving back and forth. They float up, guess where they're going? Murphy says it's not going on the side. Murphy says it's not going on the tiny little part. Murphy says, and it goes right in the roof, right on the deck lid, right where it's going to stand out the most, like the proverbial sword thumb. Bang! Now, maybe you got to do a little wet sanding, whatever, but why take the chance? Try to avoid it as best you can. Now, another thing too, and you'll hear me chirp about this later on, you will hear me repeat myself numerous times to the point where you're like, heard it before. The reason that I do that, it's not just for your benefit. It is because I want it to become second nature for you as it is for me. But I need to remind myself, because I'm so used to go, 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 sometimes I forget. A 2 ounce jar, you can buy a box of them. You can order them from DixieArt.com. I think they're $1.89 a piece. Have a couple boxes of these. This is the 3/4 ounce jar. Or 1 ounce, I forget which. That's why I got silver hair, a little bit of senility. They're nice for mixing. It's nice to have for a multitude of, or if you've got several different colors going on at the same time. Now, in the top of these, it used to be that they were either made out of cork or cardboard. Now, some genius decided that they were going to save money and they were going to make them out of styrofoam. Well, the first thing you got to do is you got to look at that, and if it's styrofoam, peel it and throw it in the garbage can. Reason being, because if you take, and I'll show you this, if you take that styrofoam and you take a drop or two of either the lacquer thinner or a drop of the paint mixed with the lacquer thinner and drop it on there, it melts. Where's that going? That's going right into your paint. And where's it coming from? Well, it's going to go through, and it's going to come right out through your airbrush, and it's going to go right on that body. Lessons learned. Now, lacquer thinner. I use Sunnyside Professional, which is a medium dry. This is sold in the hardware. Do-it-yourself carries this. Also, you can use clean strip. Now, this comes in varying sizes. Like I said, I go through this stuff like water. I airbrush a hell of a lot more than most of you are going to. You can get it in the quart cans. You can get it in the pint cans. Whatever you choose, you're the one that decides how much you're going to use. The only two that I use using the product that I use on a regular basis, which is Testor's enamels. That's right, kids, Testor's enamels. Wait a minute, old man, you can't mix. Yes, you can. Yes, you can. I was taught this when I was 18 years old by a man that I worked with. When I first got out of high school, I was the refrigeration mechanic for a school district. He's the one that taught me it. I'll tell the story some other time. It works. You take that enamel, you cut it with the cheap hardware store variety lacquer thinner, not automotive. Automotive's too hot. It's going to attack the plastic. We will go into lacquers later on down the road. What I'm trying to do right here, right now, is get you comfortable with one system and one system only. We're going to take tester's enamel, cut it with the cheap lacquer thinner, hardware store variety, at a 2-to-1 ratio. We're going to shoot it. Like I said, Jake's going to be right over my right shoulder. I did it in the airbrush DVD too. You can watch me do it. It works. It's a win-win situation. Because number one, light miscoats, you build up until you get an overall smoothness and a color. Then it's time to set it aside. But you gotta shine. You don't have to mess with anything else. Choice being, do you want to put clear over it? Yeah. You don't want to put clear on it? Just polish it up? Yeah. Can't do that with anything else. It's very easy to use. Follow my method. And the results, it's a win-win situation because you got the gloss coming out of the gun. All right. That's it for this. I can't really think of anything else that you're going to need right off the bat, except for one thing. And I'm going to do a big no-no here. You need a respirator, okay? And you need these, okay? Readily available at any Rite Aid, any drugstore, CVS, you name it, whatever's closest to you. Get the ones without the powder, powderless. This protects your hands, keeps the solvents from getting on your hand, the paint, lacquer thinner, whatever, from getting onto your skin. You need a respirator. Greg Hutchings raised hell with me when I did the airbrush DVD because I didn't wear a respirator. I said, Greg, I understand. I generally use a respirator. I said, but I can't talk during and showing what I'm doing with a respirator on. I sound like freaking Kenny from South Park. It doesn't work. So, if you look up there, Jake, spin around. I've got an exhaust fan too. You want to work in an area that's well ventilated also. Got a watch spraying in the basement, whatever. If you use an airbrush, one of the small units, the booths, readily available, Pace makes a fabulous unit. Once again, it's the cost. It's okay. I can't do that. I get claustrophobic. That's why I've got this entire room. And right now, this room looks like hell. Because this room is usually pristine, but you know what? It's winter. Kathy uses this as the garage also. So I keep this pretty clean. But my area, overall, is pretty much what I needed to be. I think that's about it. We've covered everything basically that you're going to need. Looking forward to working with you, having fun with you, and the little trolls, well, if you raise your ugly head, you'll be out of here faster than you could say spit. This is the old man. I will catch up with you soon. God bless. Have a good day.